Welcome back to Strictly Politics. We're still talking about the challenges and the difficulties posed by the world's and the Philippines' growing population. And with us tonight, Ugochi Daniels, country representative of the United Nations Population Fund, Dr. Ernesto Pernia, a professor from the UP School of Economics, and Dr. Junice Melgar, executive director of the Likaan Center for Women's Health. Dr. Pernia, you're going to say something about the inequality and the inequity and an equal distribution.
Ms. Daniels earlier was talking about the problem of inequality and inequity in the world. And the Secretary General of the United Nations, Ban Ki-moon, put it very succinctly. He said that the 7 billionth child is going to be entering a world of contradictions, which means inequality, a lot of poverty, inequality on the one hand, and a lot of wealth and riches on the other hand. But and he said, he added that it will be sad if the 7 billion baby will be entering the world of contradictions on the wrong side of the poverty divide.
Now we're showing on, on the in your screens the seven, the Filipino or the Philippines' symbolic seven billionth baby. Danica May, I think Camacho or Galura. Is she on the wrong side of the poverty line?
It would seem so, because I think the mother is a 15-year-old.
No, she's a the father is a jeepney driver.
The mother, the mother is a.
That's the second baby.
The second baby. And maybe Ms. Daniels, she was there, so she knows. She knows first. She has first-hand experience of what happened.
About the 7 billion baby.
Yeah, actually, there were about 4 or 5 mothers that were in the delivery room, so we weren't sure which baby was going to come out first. But for the actual 7 billionth baby, the symbolic baby, the mother is a housewife, and the husband is a jeepney driver. And therefore, the gifts that the baby received, particularly the scholarship, the university scholarship, as well as the sari-sari store for the parents, I think will make a significant contribution in the development of that child. But even the second child was a 15-year-old mother.
There was a second child born.
Yeah, the child that was born afterwards. But I guess this would have been, if we were going to do it symbolic, 7 billionth plus one. But just to demonstrate, you know, to underscore Dr. Pernia's point about if you're born on the wrong side of the
poverty divide.
So it's a 15-year-old mother with a preterm baby, which is what happens when young girls get pregnant, and the baby was breached, required cesarean, and then the baby would have to be rushed straight to the ICU. So it's really, you know, when you look into the future, you're really worried about what is the future going to be for these young people if you're born, you know, into these new entrants into this world, if you're born on the wrong side of the poverty divide.
So beyond the glare of the media and the attention and all the gifts that were showered on Danica, there was a more disturbing incident, I guess, during that time, and that is, you know, a 15-year-old giving birth to a preterm baby who had who was born via cesarean section. Dr. Melgar, what's the very wrong in that picture?
I think it is a very glaring picture of inequities at many levels. So even the inequity in information, it's such a an inexpensive thing. Information about the girl's bodies at 15 years old, information about how she can protect herself, and yet that has not a cost, but we are not able to have it in this country because of some prohibitions. The inequity between, not just between classes, but between men and women. I think at the center of, when we talk about 7 billion and fertility, you know, who gave birth to these 7 billion? These are women. And not all of these births were planned or even wanted by women. Some women even actually died. So as we were counting the birth of the 7 billion, Actually, we counted for that day 11 mothers dying during pregnancy and childbirth. So I think it, we have to take all of these inequities, the full picture, put the poor also there, because that means government will have to do double time to address the inequities, but also look at the gender inequity that stares us in the face, because a lot of women actually are not able to plan and have the children, the number of children that they only want.
Okay, before we continue the discussion, we'd like to bring in, because he's in the States right now, we have on the line Secretary Nerick Acosta, the Presidential Advisor for Environmental Protection. Secretary Nerick, I guess it's good morning there in the U.S.
Yes, good morning, Linda, and good morning to our fellow guests. And thank you again to Ms. Daniels and the UNFPA for bringing us together a few days ago for the 7th billion commemoration. But I'm here, for the, it's an international, in fact, it's for the environment, but particularly for lake and river basins. So I'm actually headed home, so you got me on good time.
Okay, so I hope we're not disturbing any official business or probably some.
No, perfect timing. It's only 6 in the morning.
Oh, okay. Not a very bad time after all.
Yeah.
Well, Secretary, we were talking, of course, about the UNFPA report. You were there when it was presented. We'd like to get your thoughts about the implications, you know, the challenges posed by what's going on right now, 7 billion and counting in terms of the world's population.
Right, Linda. In fact, in our launch a few days ago, I pointed to 4 implications coming especially from the framing of the environment and the larger ecology, you know, the interactions of population and technology with the environment, land, air, water, forests, seas, lakes, and then the way we govern and the way we're able to put institutions in place and make them function well. The four implications I cited are, one, with 7 billion, it brings us closer to the understanding really of carrying capacity or limits. I mean, if every child born in Asia or in richer parts of Asia were going to be using the same kind of energy or have the same kind of footprint like a child in America or Europe, studies, you know, I mean, of course, it varies, but we would need another 2 or 3 or more Earths just because of the kind of energy use, the kind of impacts. I mean, everyone produces garbage and uses energy, light, water, etc. So there's really the first understanding of carrying capacity or the limits to the ecosystems. The second is about the impacts. You know, that the more of us on Earth and the more of us in the Philippines and in very congested urban centers, we're going to be looking really at a lot of the impacts from deforestation, the conversion of agricultural land to settlements, flooding, of course, solid waste, food concerns and security, settlements, health, livelihood, etc. And that's really the second big implication. And the third is quality of life. I think our guests, Dr. Bernier and Dr. Melgar have pointed to that as well. I mean, the MDGs, the Millennium Development Goals, quality of life, what does this all mean for the average Filipino, especially for the average family and household? And fourth is the implications for institutions. I when in Congress, I authored the Clean Air, the Clean Water, the Solid Waste Management Acts. I mean, what does these all mean when we have to really enforce all these standards and bring the whole governance framework? How do we bring in local governments and communities and the private sector and all the stakeholders? I mean, it's not going to be easy, but we're talking about that, in fact, in this conference here, because more and more, we're rich or poor countries, we have to really look at, with increasing populations, you're going to have to look at an integrated ecosystems approach to everything. I think it's not enough that you can just simply say, well, this is health and that is education and this is the environment. It has to be truly integrated and holistic.
Secretary, obviously, the population, let's even just talk about the Philippine population, a very big strain on the environment. You only have to look at the videos that we've been showing of, you know, Metro Manila and the other big cities in the country where you have, you know, tons of garbage everywhere. We already have flooding. What is being done, or what needs to be done in terms of, I know this is not just going to be an environmental solution. It's going to be a comprehensive solution, but at least on the part of environmental management and making sure that there are still, you know, livable cities in the Philippines.
Yeah, absolutely, Linda. I mean, it may be a cliche to say, no, but it really boils down to, I ended with the fourth implication of governance and institutions. It's really about enforcement. I mean, we have great laws. I mean, if you really look at how we have put standards for clean air and clean water and solid waste management, biodiversity, protected areas, rivers, lakes, seas, coastal resources, we have them. But the challenge is always, how do we really enforce, especially all the way down to the grassroots and to the local communities where all of these will have to matter. So a lot of I suppose there's really a need for more of that deepening of a consciousness of leaders, in especially in local governments, but also the private sector. Mm-hmm. And how do we make that really mesh, no? And make it really effective, especially when you look at the basics of water, the basics of energy, the basics of food and health. This is really the challenge. In fact, that's why when the president asked me to look at, as a focus, the Laguna Lake Basin as the biggest in the country and the third largest in Asia, all of these factors, Linda, come together. And to answer your question really briefly is to say, wow, how do we connect all of these dots? The one that I just said, those ones that I pointed out earlier, and that's really where the challenge is, because it's not just land, air, water, forest, etc. It's how do you get people to really fully understand that everyone has a stake in all of this, and then get all of the local governments and the institutions working and implementing the laws really effectively.
Secretary, your last few words, implementing the laws effectively, I can only think of two words, their political will. But are we lacking in that department? Let me ask you, because you're the politician in this group, although I will ask them to. Why is it difficult for lawmakers and for policymakers to say curbing the population growth?
We seem to be tiptoeing
around the concept, responsible parenthood, etc. But we do not actually say that we need to curb, if we need to curb, population growth.
Well, and we know how delicate this is, Linda, and we know how controversial it is, especially in the country now, with institutional resistance, to say the least. Certain religious, we would even call it religious political divides. But I think all told, there is still a need. The challenge is for that kind of consciousness, the kind of understanding on the part of our leaders especially, but also for all of the larger public, to understand that this cannot be seen in segments. That's why I always use the word ecological, because that really means we're looking at the Philippines, we're looking at the earth as an organism, a living, you know, a set of all of these interactions, a web of life, and we're all in symbiosis. We all interact and we all impact and influence each other, and what we do to the earth and the environment comes back to us. I think that is a consciousness that still needs to be deepened, especially on the part of a lot of our leaders, Linda. So that's, in fact, that's really the challenge. I mean, it's when you can think it like that and have a consciousness, I think all of the actions and the policies follow. So that's the real linchpin there.
Yeah, well, of course, it's a very daunting task for you and the rest of our government leaders, so I'll let you meditate on that some more. I would like to thank you, Secretary Nerik, for joining us here this early in the morning there in Texas. Thank you, Secretary.
Thank you very much. All the very best, and all the best to Strictly Politics.
All right. Well, you wanted to react. I was asking, I'm sure you have your thoughts on this, of course, Dr. Yes. Melgar and Dr. Pernia. Why is it so difficult for us to say we need to curb population growth?
Well, yeah, I don't understand it, because we have been talking about this for the past four decades, maybe. I mean, since I was in graduate school, I've been doing research in this area, and there was already a lot of talk. In fact, we were among the first in Asia to have a family planning program, which started in 1969. And Thailand followed suit, practically copying our program. Mm-hmm. They started in 1971. Mm-hmm. But the thing about Thailand is they sustained their program, well-funded, sustained over time. And so that's why they have a much more manageable population now. Mm-hmm. And the balance between resources, income, housing, employment, and population, on the other hand, is pretty good. I mean, compared with ours, unemployment there is respectable at 3%. Ours is 7%. You know, poverty is down to 8%. Our poverty is 26%. Mm-hmm. I mean, what can you say? I mean, why should it be controversial? I really don't understand it. And the only thing that makes it controversial is that, you know, people just are so obsequious to the Catholic Church hierarchy for something that they don't really understand, as well as people like you and Dr. Melgar.
Meaning the women.
The women
who go give birth.
Exactly. So, I really don't understand why it is so sensitive. It's a no-brainer. It should have been done a long time ago, and we would have been much better off.
I have two theories about this thing. The second theory aligns with yours. Basically, there is a strong resistance. It's a very deliberate, systematic, well-funded resistance to family planning since the very beginning of family planning programs. And it is a very powerful resistance that actually is very focused on policymakers. So the policymakers who are elected are very vulnerable to pressure. So that's number one. Number two is we have a history of population control. Family planning did not come voluntarily in the Philippines. It was part of the dictatorship. People have very, the memories about coupling family planning, which is very family welfare oriented. But the rights, people forget that actually the Cory Aquino government introduced rights-based family planning. And our approach to family planning since the Cory Aquino time has always been rights and health-based. So that coercion that's frequently cited by legislators, by senators, that's totally false. Or if that happened at all, that happened during the watch of these certain senators who are saying that what we have is population control. That's totally false. So I think those are the factors, and these are very strong factors culturally.
So it's a I think the title of your program tonight is right. The politics of population.
There's a lot of politics.
And the
involved.
Politics of population is what is hindering the adoption of a family planning program and sustaining it over time. And that is because, I think, with due respect to our politicians, I think typically politicians are short-sighted in terms of the next election.
Meaning they only see the next blow. Election.
Yes. I mean, population is a long-term issue.
That's not very kind.
I can be disputed by politicians, but that's the problem. I think the next election is what matters. And although surveys have shown that the majority of Filipinos over and over
historically
again have been supportive of a population program and a family planning program supported funded by the government, and also they say that they support or they're in favor of politicians who would support a family planning program. They say that in surveys. Mm-hmm. And yet, our politicians are risk averse. Mm-hmm. Any little possibility that going against the church and the bishop, you know,
or some institution,
saying something unfavorable mm-hmm. against them during elections mm-hmm. may just ruin their chances. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. So they play it safe mm-hmm. instead of looking at the long term. Mm-hmm. And but there are some politicians too that look at
take
the long term and
yes.
they take a risk. Mm-hmm. And there are several supporters in Congress actually, and also in the Senate. But there are just some hardcore listeners to their bishops.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I know you want to say something, Hugo, but hold the thought because we'll have to pause for another break. Okay. Please stay with us.